Hawaii. Here.
Here.
Trustee Klingberg.
Here.
Trustee Schaefer.
Present.
And trustee Acker is absent, and Emily, the student trustee, is absent as well.
I guess closed session disclosure, we did complete our evaluation with superintendent, and have a written document that we've all signed and that he's got in his possession at the moment. We found this to be a very successful process, and Jason was telling us the other day that when he was at the AXA meeting in Monterey, that when he was sharing how we do it, that other superintendents were saying, we wish they had similar success with their boards. So we feel, we're doing a good job on that. But that's the only portable action in closed session, so we'll move on to the approval of the agenda. Any changes to the agenda that anybody noted?
I move to approve the agenda.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So we're meeting at the high school, and we thought we'd get a tour of the high school facility. I don't know who's going to lead it, but.
I'm going to lead it.
Okay.
Yeah, you'll notice that Gail is not here. She, the basketball game in Henderson Valley was rescheduled for tonight, and she felt it was very important that she go. For a variety of reasons, so she's not here, and so she just asked that her report be our tour. So I plan on just showing you classroom or two, and we'll go down and look at ROP buildings as well as the gym building, just to take a look around. And I wanted, and Roberta and Otto wanted to make sure that this is just a maybe a quarter of
visual.
The keys that they have to carry. So they took the time to make this nice key ring for me. So
I don't know whether you already had these as part of the things you were going to do, but in the SARCs that are part of our agenda today, the repair status of the interior is poor, and I wanted you to perhaps reflect on that as we go around the building.
Well, I think that, I think that for much of it is we just feel like we need to be, we need new carpet, we need a coat of paint on the walls, and the heating and the heating system is finicky, so I think that all contributes to that rating. It just needs a lot of work. It needs a lot of maintenance, and I know Otto has a desire to just knock out 1 to 2 rooms a year, but he's also kind of putting things on hold because he doesn't know the exact future of this facility, so he's waiting on that. Too.
Right. But, well, I noted that they talk about repairs being planned for the summer of 2016. I wondered why not 2015.
Yeah,
maybe that was
an error. Yeah, okay. Repairs are planned for this year as well.
Okay.
We'll hear about those in March.
All right.
Sure.
Jason, do you know what condition the classroom system is in? Is that working now everywhere?
I believe so. I believe so. I believe every classroom has a phone. We still don't have an intercom system. But we all have phones.
And the problem with the intercom system is?
I don't believe we've ever had one, unless I'm wrong about that. But we haven't had one since I've been here.
No, it's not part of the bill system. So, did you have any other comments you wanted to, before we wrap up this part?
Well, I think just some commendations, I guess, to the maintenance department. I think that, as I walked around, I haven't walked around like that in a while, and it looks better to me than it has since I've been here.
Mm-hmm.
So, we definitely have some things that we need to take care of, and we have the crew to do it. But I think Otto and Mike and James and Kyle have done a great job.
And so part of what you're doing with the high school strategic planning process is determining what the long range potential of this building is and isn't. Mm-hmm. And when do you expect to report back to us?
Well, I think hopefully by noting is something somewhat officially down by, I'd say next, less than a year from now, maybe mid-year next year.
You might want to have a special meeting just to deal with the high school and what you're developing there. There might be parents with questions and students with questions.
Yeah.
And you're ready to have that. We'll open it up.
Yeah.
So we'll move on to the consent agenda. Do you have a motion on the consent agenda?
I move that we adopt the consent agenda.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, so we'll look at reports. Student trustee is out playing basketball. Gail is attending the basketball game. You know, he's partly involved with the dispute somewhat with Anderson Valley and Mendocino kids on social media.
Yeah, it's a big game. It's probably an emotional game, so I felt like she should go, and I believe she rode the bus.
Oh, she's brave.
She rode the bus to Point Arena recently, too, so it's pretty impressive for your principal to be riding the bus with the students.
So do you want to give your report?
Sure. So clearly it's been an interesting couple of days, interesting week with the windstorm. We had power outages here at the school, at the K-8 school, I guess, on Friday. The high school never lost power that day. And I believe Albion lost power, but Comshi did not. But we lost power on Friday at 9 o'clock. And at 9:45, we were informed by PG&E that it was going to be probably about 4 hours. And so we made the decision to send all the kids home. And we were a little nervous about it. It's hard to get a hold of parents in the middle of the day. We did our automated call system. We let them know that if they were available to pick up their students at 10:30, they could come in anytime between 10:30 and 11. Buses would be running at 11 o'clock, but we assured them over the phone that we would not drop off any students without a parent standing there. And we were prepared to have students brought back to the school, but not one student was brought back. And so all students found a home that day. And the whole K-8 staff pitched in for the most part. We had probably eight staff members in the office signing kids out, making sure that they were all accounted for. So for a last-minute decision like that, it couldn't have gone any better, in my opinion. And then, of course, we did not have power on Monday anywhere, I believe. And then I received a phone call Monday night from PG&E saying that it was going to be restored. Power was going to be restored on Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock. So the decision was made to cancel school night before, which you know, I don't typically like to do that, but I think parents appreciate that warning. And then the power came on at 3:30 at my house, and I started to panic, thinking that we were going to have power and no school. But the power didn't come on at the K-8 school until 6:20, and by that time we would have had to cancel anyway because the buses leave just before 6 o'clock in the morning. So. We'll be putting in for a waiver for those 3 days with the state. But I think as far as damage goes, we didn't suffer any real significant damage. We lost a few tree limbs out on the fields, and I don't know if that window was broken from the storm or not, but we just discovered a broken window on our tour, so we'll find that out. So earlier, at the end of January, I went down to Monterey for the annual superintendent's symposium, and that was a good trip. Good trip to network with some other superintendents and discuss a lot of things. We discussed where we had a new setup where they didn't have as many speakers speaking at us. Instead, we sat at tables and they had a facilitator at each of those tables, and they just started discussions about LCFF, the LCAP, superintendent evaluation, which we already talked about, supervision process, supervision and evaluation. So it's really interesting to hear from other superintendents. So that was a good trip, and one of the best things is I was talking to another superintendent in our county, and he was just raving about the organization that he's using to help him with Prop 39. And we've been frustrated with Prop 39 in this district, trying to get some momentum behind that. And I just met today with the consultant that he's working with, the company that he's working with, and I had a great meeting. So I look forward to some movement on that in March and April. And you may have noticed on your way over here that Friendship Park is getting some work. Once again, Otto is, I can't say enough great things about the work that he's done, but he says, this is my time. And Friendship Park is something that he feels very strongly about. He's rallying crew to fix the dugouts, paint the dugouts, as well as the bathrooms. You can see the brush, old brush has been removed so they can clean it and paint it and get it possibly baseball ready for the Little League to use or the Junior Giants program that's coming to the coast this year. And we're hoping to get the prison crew there next week to do some work there too. So our lease with CCM is up in June, and I would like to just discuss Friendship Park with them. Just a desire to have that park looking nice, and I think we all want that. We all want that. CCM wants it. Our community wants it. Water is still the issue, a big issue for us. We have someone in that position now, the maintenance supervisor, who just wants to get it done. So it's exciting. It's exciting to see just the dugouts being fixed. That's all.
We had a representative from MTA here earlier.
She said that she was going to report at the March meeting.
Oh, okay.
Today.
I wasn't sure whether Mark was going to report, and no one's from CMS either. So, board trustees.
I had the pleasure of going to the Chinese New Year's Day parade today, and I think I was just sharing with other people in the audience. I think it was the biggest turnout, and it was really fun to see the kids. A lot of them dressed up. A lot of them had flags and drums, and so that was an enjoyable morning for me. And I have just been really trying to get up to the Albion School and haven't had it work out in my schedule. So that's on my plan for this month, is to just visit the site. I feel like as trustees, it's important for us to visit our home sites and check in with the teachers. So that's my plan for this month. And that's all I've got.
Nothing for me?
I put a little plug in for a vision about.
Oh, the improv tonight. Yes.
At 7 o'clock, I believe.
Yes.
I don't have anything to report either. So we'll go on to 8.1. Approval of the Moley subject teacher assigned a class under limit assignment option according to Ed Code 44865. Do you want to run us through that?
Sure. So this is, we found it necessary to have one of our special education teachers take a more of a role in teaching math, and so she this is something that we need to do. That a lot of people do that. She, I believe she's in the process of taking the test to add that credential as well. So it fits right into what she would like to do, and I just spoke with her out in the hallway, and she says it's going well. So, and Gail is also very pleased.
So what exactly approval do we need to do? Because I think in the packet there's just a form that isn't attached to a resolution.
It just requires consent, your consent, that she be able to do this.
Okay.
So I move to approve.
Okay. Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay, the next one is resolution Resolution 2015-02, which is regarding eliminating an unfilled position.
So this was an aide at Sunrise, and the aide last year went out on a maternity leave and did not return, and we have not filled the position. There hasn't been a need. So we are actually covering the hours that are necessary there with current staff. So
I move that we approve Resolution 2015-02.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, then we're up to point three, approval of board policies and administrative regulations as a first reading meeting conduct.
So the big question here last time was the abstentions, and that was an option that we could do. It wasn't protected by a code or anything, but it was recommended that we run it by legal counsel to make sure that this is something that we're allowed to do, and it is. So when a member, so the big thing here is that when a member abstains, his or her abstention shall not be counted for purposes of determining whether a majority of the membership of the board has taken action. That's the change that we brought forward.
You still need three positive votes to pass any motion.
Right.
So an abstention doesn't count for or against, correct?
Right.
Yeah, which is correct.
It's the same as if they're not.
It's a neutral.
Yeah. And then the other change was just at the number seven on the back, in the past, I don't believe that we had on there that it's just the last sentence is that when a disruption occurs that is significant enough that law enforcement needs to be contacted, it just states that that is an option for us.
But it already is an option for us.
Written,
yeah.
Right.
Right. I mean, as a citizen, we could do it.
Right. So only two changes.
Is there a motion regarding approving this as a first reading?
I'm going to approve the first reading.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Now we are 8.4. This is information only, use of school facilities.
Okay, so just want to explain this one here. So we have the policy for use of in the AR, I believe. And we have provided what we currently have as well as the gamut policy. There are no changes recommended at this time. I just like the board to take a look at it. Right now we have our policies committee scheduled to meet on the 23rd, I believe. And we'll be discussing this policy at that time as well. But I'd like the board just to look at it and be ready at the next time when we meet for the first reading of this policy to suggest any changes. I think that this policy, and I believe it's the form in here, yeah. So I believe it's just a little vague as far as the categories of uses for our facilities. You'll see later on in the AR, we have to determine if they're category A, B, or C. And I feel like that could be cleaned up a little bit. Sometimes we're put in a position where we could easily be talked into a different category. And that's a good thing, I guess, at times.
The main reason people want to be not in category C, because C, they're having to pay money.
Right.
They want to be in category A or B, where they
so
don't have to
pay. So option three, right? Option three?
Option, yeah, yes. Yeah. So, I mean, I think my preference is that you give staff as much flexibility as you can, but I understand your dilemma, which is that you don't want to appear taking sides, one group versus another group. And, you know, I think that we, I guess, if we drew a line at a profit-making group versus a non-profit-making group, or a profit, you know, a fundraising activity for an outside school group, you know, that might be one place to do, but we've made exceptions for that even when we've known it was for benefiting kids in the community. So
right.
I think you have to you're still going to have some gray area, and because I think you want to have it done. And I think in the same context, I hope you're going to examine how much insurance we require, whether we require in all instances.
Right. That's the other thing that I was going to make a mention of is that we require currently $1 million minimum, but for some activities more, and that's a good thing. However, sometimes it just seems like a lot. It seems like a lot for some of the activities. And I just feel so strongly that, you know, our schools are the hubs of our communities, and I want to make it easy for groups to use our facilities. I want to provide opportunities for our students and our community. And the more roadblocks we can take down, but in a safe way, you know, I don't want to compromise our liability either. But it just I feel like this policy might be a little too.
It's actually not policy. It's not even in the, you know, it's in the administrative regulation.
It's in the air. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think it's just a matter of adjusting that to give you or your designee discretion.
And then I'm sure we'll talk about it on Monday, but would this be a place where we would incorporate the new stuff about the new law regarding alcohol sales when kids aren't present?
I don't think so. I think that's I believe that's a separate, we'll just do that through the RV.
Well, but she's talking about, you know.
I'm saying if a nonprofit wants to come in and have a wine sale or something, that now that's allowed, and maybe this is a place to put.
But
that.
I feel like, but maybe I'm wrong. But I thought that was it was a surplus building.
The new state law says any school building that is used by a community group after hours and no children are present.
Right. There is a
loophole that now allows alcohol beverages to be served to. In that situation.
I thought it was just for surplus buildings that are owned.
No.
Or
no.
So I'm thinking that maybe it should go in here.
I was wrong on that one. Definitely.
Yeah. So I look forward to the report of the policy committee and the recommendations.
We do too. Sorry, waiting with bated breath.
Quite at 6 o'clock, we've run out of our agenda items. So I'll ask if there's anybody who came for public comment and wanted to make a comment at this time. Seeing none, we'll go on to discussing future agenda items and what's listed in the agenda, you know, as upcoming are administrative contracts, budget review, second interim report, layoffs, non-reelect probationary employees, instructional calendar, report on multi-grade classroom model, response to intervention report, SBAC testing and recording, and district technology report. So I think should be added to that list of future consideration for agenda items. Because we're having a deferred maintenance report.
Oh, right.
Next month.
March, yeah.
So our next meeting is set for March 12th at the K-8 school multi-purpose room, and we have a board retreat on March 3rd. Do you have a subject for that board retreat?
Not yet. That's something to talk to the agenda setting committee.
Okay.
Talk to you and Jessica about possible topics.
Okay. Well, thank you.
All right.
Yes.